videoconferencia. Ah, perdón, estoy empezando a hablar en inglés. No, para ustedes, creo que... Well, maybe I will say a few things in English because our guest... This video conference was organized jointly by the Institute of Biophysics and the group, el grupo de modelación de geofísica matemática y computacional. GAMC le llamamos. That's the way we call it. Well, this time we feel highly honored by having as our speaker Professor Jacob Fish from the University of Columbia. Jacob Fish is a very well-known person, especially in the field of multiscale modeling. He received his PhD in theoretical and applied mechanics from Northwestern University in Evanston, Illinois. Dr. Fish is at present the Carleton Chair Professor of Engineering at Columbia University, Director of the Multiscale Science and Engineering, Editor-in-Chief of the Journal of Multiscale Computational Engineering, Founder and President of Multiscale Design Systems. He is a recipient of the 2010 Computational Mechanics Award from the U.S. Sácalo de aquí. He's a recipient of the 2010 Computational Mechanics Award from the International Association of Computational Mechanics, IACM. Actually, it is timely to mention that he is going to host the next World Congress on Computational Mechanics at Columbia. As you probably know, just in a few months, we are going to have the World Congress in Korea, but this one, the next one, will be in Columbia University, headed by Professor Fish. This is also a high recognition for him, no? Of his merits. And the 2005 Computational Structural Mechanics Award from the U.S. Association for Computational Mechanics. Dr. Fish has written over 180 journal articles and several textbooks, including a first course in finite and practical multiscale, both from WALI. He has an accomplished record of technology transfer to industry. His multiscale methodologies have been employed by industry for manufacturing processes of GE90 fan blades, design of turbo engines for Allison engines and Rolls-Royce, simulation of aerospace structural components in Lockheed Martin and Sikorsky. So he has done a very distinguished academic, but also very relevant applications. He worked also in optimization of energy absorption mechanisms for lightweight composite cars manufactured by Ford, GM, and Chrysler. This is something new, I understand. Predicting environmental degradation of polyamide-based composites in collaboration with Boeing, GE Aviation, and Renegade Materials. Analysis of concrete targets subject to impact loading by high-speed projectiles, design of piezoelectric and ferroelectric materials, and numerous nanotechnology applications, including nanodevices and nanocomposite, sponsored by Northrop Grumman, Sandia National Laboratories, Army Research Laboratory, and Department of Energy. Professor Fish has a very significant collaboration with the Tecnológico Monterrey, and actually here with us is almost doctor. He's Arturo Mollade. We hope that in the future also you will have a strong collaboration and contact with us. We would be very honored and happy if that happens. And having said that, he's going to talk today. Professor Jacob is going to talk today on computational continuum. Jacob, please.
Thank you very much. This is my first time in Mexico City. And, it's a gorgeous city, but I think probably most amazing is not just the city, but the gracious hosts that have been with me all the time, pretty much showed me around and have been very, very kind. Ismael Herrera and Graciela and many others. So thank you very much for your hospitality. It really has been a great experience. So today I'm going to talk about some of my recent work. I have been working in multi-skin methods for over 25 years already. And you know, we work in academia. We write a lot of papers. I mean, this is one of the things that we do in academia. But I think sometimes it happens that what we do really makes an impact. It makes an impact on industry, and you know, a lot of things, a lot of papers that we publish, probably another 100 years nobody will mention. This is just, it's not me, this is just how it happens. But there are very few things that they continue, and they have a real impact, and they continue to develop. And I think what I want to talk today is maybe a small subset of my work that I believe had already an impact, and I believe will continue to have an impact. So, all right, so let me first of all talk to you a little bit about the background of multi-scale methods. And I want to point out between the divergence of what multi-scale method perceived in academia and what the impact they actually made in real life. So if you, and you know, this number might be wrong, but if you type in Google multi-scale, you're probably going to get about 4 million hits. Maybe today is more because I prepared this presentation some time ago. So it's clearly it's an important word. If you do that 30 years ago, 20 years ago, maybe you'll get 20, 30 hits. So it actually went quite a bit up. There are a number of journals that have the title in multi-scale methods. And if you look today in the United States, there are faculty positions specifically targeting people that do work in multi-skin methods. So it's actually a very popular topic. And in a recent US National Congress in computational mechanics, 400 talks out of 1,600 talks were in multi-skin methods. So clearly this is something that academia is interested in. Applications, of course, range in materials, biology, weather predictions, finance, and many other areas. I just mentioned some of them that maybe even you are surprised that that multi-skin methods are used in those areas. I want to make a case study, pick one of the areas, and just show you in detail the actual divergence between academia and what happens in industry. So if you take, for instance, a field of composite materials, which is one of the fields where multi-skin methods are actively employed, and you look at this field, this is about, in 2016, this field have about $27 billion in actual usage in industry, production of materials, usage of those materials, design of those materials. So it's about $27 billion industry, just composite materials, right, which are used in, you know, transportation, wind energy, aerospace, automotive energy. So clearly, you know, perhaps not the greatest industry, but about $27 billion, and this is just in the United States. If you look at the, what is the amount of monies that went into the design of those things using multi-skin methods, it's almost negligible. I think the total revenue of all the companies in the world that produce multi-scale software is negligible. It's only $20 million. So the question is, you know, why there is such a huge industry and why this is not employed, really, in industry. And the answer to this is usually it's too complex, and most of the things are done by testing, by physical testing. This is how the design mostly guided. And, you know, this is a taken from the Handbook of Composite Materials. It's called CMH17. And basically, you build structures of different size, and you test them, and you break them. Obviously, at the coupon level, you build more. You study those things in different environmental conditions, different temperatures. And so you can build more of those. They're small. They're not that expensive. And as you go up to the structure, let's say to Boeing 747, you maybe do one experiment, right, because it's so expensive. But pretty much everything is done by, you know, building and testing, building and breaking, not really much by employing multi-skin methods. So the question is, why there was such a slow adoption of technology that we in academia are really very much excited about, but why industry is really not adopting this? So I would mention a couple of things. First of all, is a tremendous computational complexity. If you look into a nonlinear problem, let's say you want to predict failure of systems, right? And if you look at the component that you want to analyze, think about this macro problem being the whole airplane. And think about a material point, which is just a material point, and it's made of complex microstructure, right? And you really want to understand how the processes at this scale affect the well-being of the whole plane, right? So what you typically do, what you typically have to do if you use classical multi-skin methods, maybe not that classical, because classical multi-skin methods, you know, they typically deal with linear problems. But if you do kind of the, you know, maybe not so classical multi-skin methods, you pretty much have to solve a nonlinear boundary value problem at every point in the plane. And you have to continue to do that. Obviously, this is a finite element model here, typically, that may include million degrees of freedom. You have a plane itself that may include maybe several million degrees of freedom. And at every point now in the plane, you have to solve this boundary value problem, which is a nonlinear boundary value problem. And since the system, typically you solve nonlinear problems in incremental fashion. You kind of increase the load all the time, because otherwise the Newton method is not going to work, right? And each time you come there, and you have to solve a nonlinear boundary value problem at every point. Basically, those that use finite elements, you pretty much will solve a boundary value problem at every quadrature point. And we have to continuously do that. And then the solution of this basically lets, you know, you allow you to solve this, you know, the larger problem. So the computation complexity is really tremendous. It's really not even feasible to do something like that. You know, on theoretical level, maybe you guys have a fantastic parallel machines. Obviously, all those problems can be done in parallel. So if, let's say, you have 10 million elements, and if you have 10 million processors, right, then perhaps you can solve each of those on a processor, right? And obviously that would help quite a bit, right? But let us suppose we don't have 10 million processors, right? And so the question is, you know, what do we do? And, you know, here I said, you know, chose, you know, just kind of problems that I personally have been working with. So this is an example of a composite, which is, you know, a field which is close to me. You can do this thing in concrete, you can do this thing in metals, where you look at the polycrystalline structure of different grains. You can use this thing in soils, you can do this thing, and you can also do those things even at the atomistic scale, where the cell at which you have to solve the problem is not necessarily has to be governed by partial differential equations. It can be governed by other principles, by molecular dynamics principles, by, you know, if you're talking about soil modeling, it could be governed by discrete element method, where you have to look at the interaction of different soil grains. So what you do here at this scale, there could be a variety of systems that solve by a variety of methods. Typically, the system at the macro scale, you know, typically at the continuum system, right, governed by PD. But as you go to those finer scale problems, they could be governed by not necessarily partial differential equations, but perhaps by other principles. Now, I'm here trying to explain why multi-scale methods are not that popular in the industry. So another challenge, in addition to computational complexity, is uncertainty. And that's a huge problem. This is actually a material system that I'm currently working on. This is a ceramic matrix composite. It's a 6-6 system where the cost of this system is as high as the cost of gold, because this is a material that can withstand 27 degree Fahrenheit and used in high temperature engine. Very, very expensive material. But as you can see, has a tremendous amount of defects. It has a tremendous amount of defects. It has a pores. It has those micro cracks. You know, you make one sample, you make another sample, you see something else, right? And you need to take into account the fact that you don't deal with a discrete, with a deterministic system, like Graziella explained yesterday. You actually have to deal with stochastic systems, right? So that's another challenge. And this is actually an example where I was recently working with Rolls-Royce Aerospace, and we tried to predict fatigue flight predictions. And, you know, I'm not telling exactly what the coupon was, but there was a coupon, and you can see some of those points were predictable. But there were some experiments where components fail instead of, 10 in the power of 7 cycles, they fail at 3 orders less cycles. And that's because of those defect structures. Sometimes there is a coalescence of those defects, and this is a problem, right? How do you account for those things? So now that we are understanding the challenges that we have, I would like to give you, first of all, the general framework, how we're trying to approach problem of this tremendous complexity, and how can we overcome some of those tremendous challenges that we have. So the first thing is, of course, where do you start? You know, multi-scale methods, you know, I once was reviewing some National Science Foundation proposals, and I see professors are telling that they can start at the quantum scale, and they go all the way to the airplane. They're proposing to do this research in 3 years, and then they're going to solve all the problems. You know, this is not really feasible. So typically, why do we want to use a multi-scale method in the first place? Because it's probably better than a single-scale method. But is it always better? And that is not necessarily true. It's not necessarily better always to use multi-scale methods. You always have to start from somewhere where you have to understanding about the governing equations better than if you're not going to do that. So you have, let's say, a heterogeneous system. It's very hard to understand how it's going to behave because it's very heterogeneous, right? I mean, we can do a lot of testing, but even if we're going to do a lot of testing, and we cannot do millions of tests, we can do a number of tests. The question is, can we do from a handful of those tests and characterize the behavior of that system? In general, not. I mean, if you do a linear characterization, possibly. But if you try to do a nonlinear characterization with a handful of tests, it's typically not possible, because we really don't understand how those things behave once they get into this nonlinear regime. So the question is, if you try to model this at the finest scale, will you have a better understanding about what happens at this finest scale? And in many cases, you do. Take, for instance, polymer matches composites, so you carbon, you know, mixed with the polymer. So typically, you know, behave of carbon. We have experience of how carbon behaves. We know how the polymer behaves. And if we then understand how to upscale that information all the way to a nonlinear regime, then we can, with less characterization, we can characterize polymer, we can characterize carbon, and then by simulation, predict how this thing going to behave together. Right? So there are many, many cases where this is essentially quite useful. So we start from somewhere, and when I say we start from somewhere, is from the best thing to start from somewhere where you have the best understanding about the system with minimum uncertainty. That is usually should be our starting point. And sometimes there isn't such thing, and the only thing that we have is there's a single scale, and then we do single scale. We'll do many, many experiments, and we'll characterize this thing at a single scale. So we do this characterization, and we need to do characterization, and that system here can be continuous or discrete. It can represent multiple physics. It can represent large deformation. And typically, that system has to be characterized in stochastic sense. Now the big challenge. We have the system. Let's say we understand the partial differential equation. We know the mathematical model, right? We know the mathematical model. The problem is that, as I already told you before, that mathematical model is huge in terms of its computation complexity. Solving that model for nonlinear system is very, very expensive. And then the key thing here, and that is, I would say, has been the major hurdle for industry, is that because there is so much information, and you really cannot carry on that information all the time and deal with that information repeatedly in the process. So really the key challenge is, how do you take this tremendous amount of information that you have and try to reduce to a manageable size, but still has the necessary insight into what would you need to predict, what in terms of quantity of interest at the larger scale. And that is that has been the subject of a variety of reduced order models. How do you reduce information? How do you systematically reduce? And you know, one of the contributions of this work is that ability to systematically and accurately reduce information. Now, once you reduce information, once you have some sort of a reduced information, and now you try to go to your Boeing 747, right? You have something, you try to go there. And typically, the classical approach is a homogenization, or some sort of a variant of homogenization that has been known for many, many years, going back into Lyons, Papa Nicolaou, the French school, Eva Babushka with his own methods in 70s. I think engineers have tried to do those things actually even before that. And the underlying assumptions of those approaches, and there are different variations, the underlying assumptions of all those approaches is that there is a separation of scale. There is something very big and there is something very small. And there are a variety of variations. The thing is that in practice, in practical application, as a Boeing engineer, and actually I have been an aerospace engineer before I started to pursue my academic career, right? As an aerospace engineer, I can tell you that in reality, scales are not separable. And if you assume that, you're actually making tremendous error. Not of 2, 4, 5, 10%, hundreds of percent error. Give an example. Take a classical problem of a plate with the hole. Right? We all love this problem. We all study this problem because it's a very simple problem. It turns out to be that the characteristic size of the hole in aerospace components is, you know, something like that, maybe half a centimeter. You know, you have to bring in wires through those. The characteristic size of the material that is used in aerospace structures, typically a woven composite, is of the size of 1 or 2 centimeters. So the hole is a structural feature. That's your structure. The material scale is at the same size as the hole that you're talking about, right? So there is clearly scale mixing. Not only that there is scale mixing, there is a scale mixing in the critical regions that are responsible for the failure of, or the ultimate capacity of your system. Right? So it is a huge problem to use homogenization methods that are really, you know, not that they're not only accurate, they're really wrong in the critical regions in the problem domain. So the question is there is an alternative? Is there, and what I'm saying, obviously there are alternatives. There are many, many alternatives. But the question is there is a simple computational efficient alternative that will not penalize and will not the whole make this whole process so cumbersome that it's not going to be applicable in real systems? And so this is something that I'm going to be talking today about, an approach which replaces homogenization in the limit as the size is going to go to shrink to zero, and there are many, many systems where material scale is much, much smaller. This approach that I'm going to talk today will reduce, right, to the classical homogenization, which is obviously nothing wrong about the method. We know the mathematics of this approach very well. But for practical systems where scales are not separable, we need to have an alternative. So I'm going to talk about this approach, and then once you have this in place, then we can consider systems where that are scale separation free. I also want to have systems, I want to have also an approach that can use a classical discretization methods, you know, C0 continuous methods, right? You know, there are methods which are require high order continuity. They're very, very cumbersome. I'm not a big fan of those kind of approaches. I would like to use, you know, something very, very classical that we have been working for many, many years. All right. Finally, we want to have some sort of a design environment by which we can also have some feedback loop by which we will be able to analyze the system and feedback and sometimes optimize, you know, some fine scale features so that, you know, we can optimize costs. This is also something that we would like to have. So this approach that I've been talking about and something that I'm going to be talking about, you know, has been translated into actual real product. That and you know, you mentioned some of the companies that I've been using. So in 2008, I founded a company which I called Multiscale Design System, or MDS. The funding primarily came from small business initiative in United States. You know, government helps to small companies to become successful. We released our first program in 2013. We had 12 large customers. And in 2015, All My Trouble finished. We were acquired by a much larger company, which is called Altair. And maybe you're familiar with HyperWorks, HyperMesh, OptiStruct. This is one of the big players in computer design. So this technology is now making a much bigger impact than I could do it myself. So it continues. So let me now talk a little bit about, put you some equations. This is also a seminar in applied mathematics. So we obviously have to put some equations on the board. And I'm going to do that. So we want to solve a boundary value problem. From a mathematical point of view, it's a boundary value problem with oscillatory coefficients. The system, the coefficients could be, the system could be either periodic or periodic in a statistical sense, right? So you can still have a random microstructure, but it is homogenizable, right? Which are most of the systems are. I would like to deal with large deformation systems. So taking from the textbook, you would typically have capital X and little x to denote undeformed and deformed coordinates. Typically, if you look at the books of mathematicians, you would see that different quantity has the superscript psi to denote that there is somewhere a fine scale there. Typically, so this is typical nomenclature taken from some books in mathematics, Papanikolaou, Lyons. We like to write our governing equations in terms of the conjugate measures, and so typically in this literature for large deformation problems, nonlinear system, we like to use a pair of first Piola-Kirchhoff stress and the deformation gradient as the conjugate measure. This way, everything can be written with respect to the initial undeformed configuration, right? Obviously, everything can be transformed to anything else later on, but this is how we like to state our equations. I'm not writing any constitutive equation here. Obviously, this is, you know, there are some boundary conditions. This is a definition of a deformation gradient. I don't want to write any boundary conditions here, any constitutive equations. So obviously, the system incomplete because I want to remain here general. We can deal with variety of materials here. If you were to use homogenization, by the way, then if you take a classical book on a homogenization, you will basically what you do, you take a microscope, you zoom into the point, and you see the whole world. And this zoomic factor is by 1 over xi, where xi is a small parameter, right? Small parameter, small scaling parameter. And then you pretty much attach a new coordinate system, which is the microscale coordinate system. Again, you may have deformed and undeformed configuration as well. And you typically use asymptotic methods, very popular in this field, and you get and you can start with the complex system, and you can decompose that into governing equations at different scales using asymptotic methods, and again, the basic assumption here is that the scales are separable. That's why you can introduce this coordinate system here, which scaled with respect to this macroscopic system by this scale parameter. Now, before I'm going to tell you what we are doing and what we came up, I would like to review some of the work that have been not done in mathematical community, but they have been done in continuum mechanics community, going to Midland, going to Variety, going to Nemeth Nasser more recently, but you know, in some continuum mechanics community, and but going back to 1960s, which in mechanics they call that golden age of continua or generalized continua. So, if it turns out to be, and of course their derivations can be very very different, more based on the physics principles. Based on the energy equivalence between energies at different scales. But it turns out to be that there is a connection between what mathematicians have been doing with asymptotic methods and what engineers have been doing based on all kind of energy principles. And if you are going to be using asymptotic expansion, and if you are going to be assuming that there are some high-order gradients of the solution, you can obtain what Midland obtained in 1964, which is a variational principle. Here, W is the test function. You could obtain the variational principle where, if you look at that, you have this P, which is the macroscopic first Piola-Kirchhoff stress, and then you can have all kind of couples. You can think about them kind of moments, and you can have high-order moments, and so forth. One of the things, and so you can actually connect with, you know, there is, you can create that connection between asymptotic methods and more engineering approaches. But what I would like to point out, the following thing. That is, in deriving this equation, we have been making a very fundamental assumption. We basically have been exploiting the following equation, that if you have to do, if you have to integrate over functions that are depending on the multiple scales, you can actually first average this on the finite scale and then integrate that over the macroscopic scale. And of course, this is only valid as long as there is a scale separation. That means as long as this psi parameter is infinitesimally small. If you also look at this equation here, you see that there is a second derivative of the test function. And there is obviously the classical first derivative of the test function, but there is also a second derivative of the test function, which means that you would have to use high-order continuity, right, in when you do a discretization, something that, that we also don't like to do. So how can we remove those classical assumptions that we require infinitesimality of scale separation? We don't want to have that. And how can we create a method that does not require C1 continuity, can still use classical C0 continuity? So this is my goal. And also I want to have a method which is computationally viable, a method that can be solved very fast. So not only that I want to remove the limitations, I also want to get something that I can analyze very efficiently for nonlinear systems. All right, so the building blocks are so-called non-local quadrature and residual-free fields. And these are the two subjects that I want to talk about in detail. All right? So before I talk about that, let me, you know, do this kind of like a cartoon here. Suppose that this is our finite element mesh in two dimensions. If I were to use a classical homogenization method, typically what we do, we think about that we have those unit cells or representative volume elements, and they're sitting at the quadrature point. This is kind of nice to visualize it this way. And then what we do, we're basically calculating some deformation measure. In this case was deformation gradient, and we subject that as some boundary conditions on this, and we solve that boundary value problem. In reality, of course, this is only true as long as those cells are infinitesimally small. As you can see, they shrunk. They have to be really, really small. And then, if this is the case, then everything works. Now, if they are not small, like what you see here in this picture, then we obviously cannot do that because we don't have a theory to do that. The homogenization theory does not deal with those kind of cases. So here is an idea. We define a computational continuum domain, which is a disjoint union of computational unit cells. I call them computational unit cells. So we define this so-called computational continuum domain, which is a disjoint union of computational cells. And once we define that domain, once we define that computational domain, computational continuum domain, we're then going to be approximating integrals on this multi-scale medium as a summation of integrals over those computational cells multiplied by some weight. So it's a weighted average. The parameter, so the question here, what is the weight and what is the location of those cells? The location of those cells is not going to be location of quadrature points. So I'm asking myself, is it possible to find locations of those cells? And is it possible to find weights so that this indeed going to be true? So this is, at this point, it's a hypothesis. Is it possible to do that? And so I'm going to show you, going to prove you this, that it's indeed possible on a very one-dimensional problem And then I will explain you how to generalize that to three dimensions. All right? So let us suppose that I want to analyze a 1D problem. And let us suppose that this is my physical domain, and this is my finite element from A to B. And this, let's suppose that theta is the size of my material scale. This is the size of my microstructure. And it's a finite. It's not infinitesimally small, it's finite, right? So I'm going to approach as if I'm trying to derive my Gauss quadrature. So if you have taken a course, students in finite elements, I'm sure professors derive to you Gauss quadrature, which is most popular approach in calculating integrals in finite elements. Of course, you can do that in a variety of other ways, but this is one of the most popular approaches for smooth systems, right? So what do we do when we derive Gauss quadrature? We take this physical element and we map that into parent domain, right? So we do that in 1D, we do the same thing in 2D. So the parent domain, in this case, I choose that from minus 1 to 1. So now we squeeze everything into this domain. So obviously we also map the microstructure, we map all this thing. All right. So now we have to calculate this integral. So we describe this integral in the parametric domain. And we denote now the integral as phi prime. And now we want to approximate that as some weights, unknown weights, and summation of unknown weights of the integrals on those cells. So psi I is the position, is unknown position of the cell. And I want to integrate that, this integral over the domain of this cell. So the question is, can I find such a psi I, position of cells, and such a weight, right, so that I can get a closed form expression of this integral? So how do we derive Gauss quadrature? I'm going to do exactly the same. You approximate your integrant in as a polynomial, right? As a smooth polynomial, because you assume that the function is smooth, so approximation is good. And now you approximate this, now you can integrate this polynomial exactly, because you know how to integrate polynomial. Of course, the final integral is going to be a function of those coefficients, a1, a2, a3, and a4, right? Those are coefficients in this polynomial. And now you also can apply this, what I call non-local quadrature, which I call actually this expression here, as a non-local quadrature. And I can integrate all this thing, all those psi's, using this non-local quadrature. And I get this expression here. With weights and the position of quadrature points is unknown. And now I'm saying, as we do that in Gauss quadrature, that every term here has to be exactly. So the term that multiplies A1 here and here has to be the same. And then I get a system of nonlinear equation with unknowns as weights and the position of quadrature point. Here what you get. For two-point Gauss quadrature, you get that the position of the quadrature points is minus plus square root of 1/3 minus psi prime, theta prime, divided by 12. Now, theta prime is the size of the unit cell in this map domain, right? So if theta prime is equal to 0, you get the classical Gauss quadrature, right? If theta prime, let's say, is not 0, consider two cases. Theta prime equal to 2, which means that the size of the cell is equal to the size of your element, right? Because your element goes from minus 1 to 1. Then you get that the quadrature point on this actually moves from minus plus square root of 1/3. It moves to the center. And another interesting case, theta prime equal to 1 when the unit cell size equal to half of the element size. Right? And then you get another interesting result, minus plus half. So it's in the middle of the two sides. right, on the two sides of the element. So you can see that you actually develop a quadrature scheme that is actually exactly equal to the exact solution, if the solution is smooth. And your quadrature scheme is now depend on the elements on the size of the microstructure in comparison to the element size. Right? You can do the same thing for other higher order elements, right? And you would get, in this case, in the previous case, the weights were still one, so they were independent of the size of the microstructure. But if you consider high order fields, the weights themselves become a function of the microstructure. So you can see that indeed in 1D it is possible to do what I've just tried to tell you before, but it's also possible to do that. I skipped on, did I skip that? Yeah. For some reason I skipped that. Well, it is possible to do the same thing. What you can do, basically the idea is to match the monomials. So you can always, even if you have a complex element in multi-dimensions, you know, whatever that element is, it has certain monomials in the parent element domain, and you can integrate those monomials exactly, and you can integrate those monomials using quadrature scheme, this non-local quadrature, and you can again match them. And you will have to solve larger systems, but you can develop quadrature schemes for problems in multi-dimensions as well. I for some reason, I don't have that slide. So how do you then derive the core scale problem? You basically do what you do it in classical variational multi-scale method, like one of them. You take your partial differential equation. So this is to derive a coarse problem. You take a partial differential equation. You take a coarse scale test function. So these are the test functions on the coarse mesh, right? And you're basically getting here a number of terms. But the term that has to do with the test function times the derivative of the stress, in order to integrate that term, you will use this non-local quadrature scheme, right? And I'm not going to get into the details of that, but you can use that, and you get what you get. To get a fine-scale problem, you do a very similar thing that you do in variational multi-scale method. You take your partial differential equation, you take your oscillatory test function in your representative volume element, and you integrate this thing. So this function is a periodic function defined in the this computational unit cell. You again do integration by parts, and you can get a nonlinear problem for your fine scale problem. Typically, this nonlinear problem is going to be very complex because it's a problem defined in RVE with all the details of RVE, and therefore my second topic here is how do you systematically reduce information. So my first topic was what I talked about for now, was how can you get a method that can produce C0 continuous approximations as well as the method that is free of scale separation. Now I want to talk about the computational efficiency. So model reduction, right? And the idea here is model reduction based on construction of residual free eigenfields. All right? So this is so here is an idea. Let me now, for simplicity, write this thing in terms of the Cauchy stress. And let me use a very classical inelastic constitutive equation, which is basically written in the rate form and the incremental form, where all the inelastic information I lump into so-called eigenstrain. Now, not all the nonlinear equations behave that way. You can classify nonlinear equations nonlinear mechanical equations, right? And also for the physics problems, where you have an additive decomposition of rate of deformation. But there are also problems where you have to use a multiplicative decomposition, which this framework is not going to be useful for that part of, for those kind of problems. But you know, about 95-97% of considered equations, you know, you can separate elastic and inelastic response in this additive form, right? And this is the form that I'm going to focus now. All right. I'm going to also decompose my macroscopic field, my rate of deformation here for large deformation problems, into core scale rate of deformation, and into oscillatory part, you know, the perturbation part. And the basic idea is this equation here, which can be proved to be correct for all the system. And this is actually a beautiful equation if you think about this thing. The idea here is to approximate this perturbation, this oscillatory field. So we say that we have a deformation that is a core scale deformation plus something that captures the oscillation. And the idea is, how do you approximate this oscillation? The idea here is the following. You try to describe that by some, so we call that influence functions, H, multiply that by the macroscopic rate of deformation. Then you have some other influence function. You can think about them being Green's functions, if you like. They're very much, you think about them as numerical Green's functions, which means that if you have a domain and you subject that to some unit macroscopic field, what would be the response, right? So you can think about this as kind of a Green's function. So this is the response of the system when you subject that system to the unit gradients of the rate of deformation. Now, this term is actually very, very interesting. So what is the effect of nonlinear behavior on this solution? And the idea here is the following. This H is a Green function, is the solution of the elasticity, of the portion of elasticity solution on this oscillatory field. When you apply a unit inelastic deformation in some infinitesimal volume in your microstructure. So if you take that infinitesimal volume and you deform that in all possible deformation modes, what is an influence of that going to be on your perturbation of the solution? It's again, it's a result of solving at this level here. You can solve infinite number of problems numerically by taking a small domain, an infinitesimal domain, subjecting that on a small volume and finding the elasticity solution to that. That would be this H. The summation of all possibilities of all infinitesimal perturbation, that's the overall effect of what I call this eigenstrain. Eigenstrain is everything, right? It's an influence of inelastic deformation. It's an influence of transformation field. It's influence maybe of thermal effects, diffusive effects, other physics effects. We typically call that as an eigenstrain. That's what?
That's an eigenfield?
That's an eigenfield. Now, we also have...
Why eigen?
Huh?
Why do you use eigen?
This is... The name came from Toshio Mura. I mean, you know, this is from very classical works of mechanicians, and they called it eigenfield. I didn't come up with this name.
Mm-hmm.
Right? This is what I call an eigen separation. I think this is probably my invention. And they call this eigenfields. So I call those eigenstrains, which is a classical name. And this I call that eigen separation. All right. So this is my name. And the idea here is the following: if you have a heterogeneity, and there is some debonding, there is some separation jump in the solution between those phases, and in many cases things debond. You talk about metals. There is emotions, relative motions of grains. You talk about concrete. You talk about other things. There is some jumps in the solutions. I mean, I think you showed in in your approach the importance of the jumps of the solution.
Yeah.
So I call this as an eigen separation, this jump, right? And this is basically a Green's function that describes if you take an infinitesimal jump somewhere, what is the effect? So it can be proved that you actually can get the solution of the influence of many of those things by actually superposition, by actually adding all those effects. This actually can be proved. I'm not going to go through this thing. So once you have to decompose this, obviously you can put this thing into differential equations. You can write a weak form for that. And then you can go and do a discretization. We actually discretize those eigenfields. We discretize those eigenstrains. We discretize those eigenseparations using, here you actually can use C-1 discretization. Here you have to use a C0 continuous discretization. I'm not going to get into this. There are issues here of locking. We, in order to get a very practical method and a very fast method, you have to use a very low order of approximations of those fields. Because the higher order approximations you're going to get, the higher computational complexity you're going to be. We like to use, in our commercial product, we use, for each microphase, we use a constant approximation of eigenstrain. We use a constant, so basically you have piecewise constant approximation of those eigenstrains. We use also piecewise constant approximation for the interfaces. And as a result of that, there are issues, there are issues in lower order approximations of finite elements. There is an issue of locking. There is also an issue of locking here. Not going to get into details, but we devise some methods that allow to alleviate that locking.
So you are using discontinuous functions?
We are using discontinuous functions, yes.
What theoretical framework do you use for handling the discontinuous functions?
So they are...
discontinuous Galerkin or what?
No, we're not using discontinuous Galerkin. The discontinuous function there is because the eigenstrains are allowed to be discontinuous. In other words, there is no derivative of eigenstrain in variation principle. So you don't have to use anything spatial, right?
Well, I find that interesting because I have...
So we don't have to use discontinuous.
Handling of discontinuous representation.
So if you had smooth functions and you want to have a discontinuous approximation, obviously discontinuous Galerkin would be one of the approaches. Here we don't have that. So we just, we are allowed to use C-1 functions. If you look at this system here, in order to calculate those influence functions, those Green's functions. So, by the way, what you see now here, by doing this discretization, obviously, those eigenstrains, the physical meaning of this thing becomes, rather than applying this Green's function in the infinitesimal domain, you're basically now taking those large finite domains and you deform them, and you look at the influence of them on your solution, right? So we basically replace the requirement of solving infinite number of problems by solving a finite number of problems, right? And we can numerically solve for those Green's functions. Basically, now they become like a numerical Green's functions. And what we end up having, we are reducing this very huge problem at the micro scale to a very small problem, to a problem that we also can control its accuracy because we can control the discretization, right? Again, my personal interest was to produce an engineering product. So we haven't done too many studies of rates of convergence, of how those discretization affect convergence. But just to show you the size of the problems that you get, you're basically getting those, you solve nonlinear systems on this complex domains with just a handful of unknowns, right? You know, you would have here 27 unknowns or something like that.
CUC program.
Oh, computational unit cell program. All right. I mean, I'm not going to get into the detail. Just going to show you very simple examples. This is an example of a beam bending. You know, we use, in this example we have 8 macroscopic elements. Each one is a serendipity element, 20 node element. Very large microstructure. We intentionally take something like that. You know, you have a cell. And we have a cell size equal to the element size. Okay, so very large. Obviously, if you were to use homogenization, so here we solve this problem using direct numerical simulation. No homogenization, just everything single scale. And this is used as a reference solution, right? So you can see at the critical point, basically, this is kind of direct numerical simulation solution. If you were to use classical homogenization, so you would, you know, you obviously would have quadrature points on the top, quadrature points on the bottom here. So the quadrature point on the top would give you something like that. The quadrature point on the bottom would give you something like that. Obviously, none of them has anything to do with reality, right? Obviously, you can see that. This is the real thing. This is what your method, homogenization method, will tell you, right? And this also have a tremendous influence on the macroscopic response. It does. I mean, if you show force displacement relation, which is very important for engineers, right? It has huge impact.
Excuse me. Do you have this in your most recent book?
Yes.
This is in. Could be nice.
Yeah. I think Arturo has it. Yes. So this is chapter 5 in the book. So the book starts with, you know, classical thing, Papanikolaou, Lyons, goes to nonlinear systems, you know, more recent works, and then it does with
Papanikolaou was very close to Lyon.
Yes, of course.
Okay. Yeah. I look forward.
And you can also do more complicated system. This is a classical woven composite that is used in aerospace. And again, you can see that. So this basically also shows the moment convergence as you increase the size of Xi. Basically, Xi equal to 1, basically the very large your cell. Xi equal to 0 is a homogenization, right? So you see in the homogenization, everything gives the same result and gives the same result as DNS. As you increase the Xi, the order one solution basically tells you that the solution doesn't change, because the order one solution doesn't know anything about the size of the microstructure. It's not part of this, right? So it doesn't capture the size effect issues. And some other examples. There is some non-locality, you know, if you do failure, interesting enough that this method gives you actually mesh insensitive results as, you know, this when you have failure processes. This is the recent work that we're doing with GM. It's a typical nonlinear problem. The microstructure here is actually a random chopped fiber, or actually chopped toe composites. So you can see that this microstructure sits at every quadrature point here, right? And actually, not only that it sits at every quadrature point, it actually, there are many layers, because, you know, in order to integrate for nonlinear problems, you have to divide that into layers, and you have to put this microstructure at every quadrature point at every layer, right? And, you know, if you would try to do this thing with a classical homogenization methods, you would see that this thing probably going to run forever. Maybe your supercomputers will be able to do that better, because there are not many quadrature points here. I think maybe 20,000. So if you put everything on a processor, it's probably going to work well. I don't have those tools. You know, this was done actually on an 8 processor machine, and very, very fast comparison to experiments. This is the work on fatigue. I didn't talk about fatigue, but we also have approach in multi-scale in space and time. And the way we approach fatigue is through introducing multiple temporal scales. Why there are multiple temporal scales is because there is an oscillatory application of the load, like flights, one flight after another flight, right, which is like a cycle. And there is a slow degradation of properties at a different scale, right? The properties could degrade in over 10 years. Then you have to replace or repair the plane. So that introduces multiple temporal scales. So we have this approach. I didn't talk about that. This is actually a fatigue of this tail cone. This is a component in a Rolls-Royce engine. And I model here just a portion of that. It has some attachment holes, as you can see here. And the cracks are starting to propagate with those noise vibration over time. And you can see there is this crack that propagates over many, many cycles and creates those large cracks. And there are some comparison to test data at different load frequencies, et cetera, et cetera. We also, this is a subject that I didn't talk about that, but we also do the, you know, wave propagation. I know that this was your work, Ismail. But the idea here is, again, to capture the wave dispersion. So we're considering large microstructures, shocks propagating in those microstructures. Then, as you probably know, they are trapped in the microstructure. The wave starts bounce back and forth in this microstructure. So this kind of approach have excellent dispersive properties. I can show you some cartoons here, but I think in the interest of time, I'm going to just skip on that.
This work is for what? For what?
This work is for dynamics. Is primarily crash and impact. So crash of composite cars. Impact of missiles. So this is a project that I had maybe 10 years ago, studying concrete. This was the, you know, kind of a toy problem of a bunker. I think that was about the time that there was a war in Iraq, and they were interested in.
What is this? This
is a missile. This is missile.
Ah, missile. All right.
So this was at the time when there was a war in Iraq, and they were interested in see how can you penetrate the bunkers of Saddam Hussein, and so there were some work done in those areas. And of course we tried, so there is this also dispersive approach here that I have not talked about that.
So you have chokes there.
I had
that problem. You have chokes. You have to deal with chokes.
Chokes?
Which? Sure, discontinuous solution.
Discontinuous solutions, yes, yes. This is a part of the work on crash of composite cars. Some reason, I don't know why it's not working.
That the discontinuous solution is sufficient, or you have to also to
No. We don't introduce discontinuous solution. We just introduce very, very high gradients, and we try to resolve.
So you work with the shock profile.
Yes, we resolve the shock profile. Yeah. So anyhow, this some works on. Now it works for some reason. This is some works of, you know, the idea here is to be able to predict the.
It's not interesting to know, to see how you handle the shock profile.
Okay. Shock. Yes. Yes.
The smoothing of the
I can mail it. We publish like 20 papers.
That I am submitting.
Okay.
It's a procedure that.
Okay.
It's not the standard one.
So, we have variety of approaches. Some of our approaches, again, were based on the space-time, multi-scale method in both space and time. So in time, basically, so there is a wave propagation, and there is also the time scale of the wave oscillating in the microstructure. So there are multiple temporal scales. There is a slow time scale. So this was part of the work done. We have done all kind of approaches in this regards, and you know, published many works. Maybe not as much as you, but we have done some work as well. This is a work that I did for Navy. Also related to some wars that United States had in Iraq, so we typically they would take with a poluria, they would take tanks, they would take all kind of army vehicle, and they would spray that with a material called poluria, and it turns out to be that this poluria has some excellent energy absorption properties. So typically the missile come on the metal side.
What is the poluria, a material? Or?
It's a material. It's a material. It's kind of a material. So it's kind of material that has excellent energy absorption properties. What we were looking is into putting some particles into this poluria to enhance its performance. And in this case, so there were some experiments also done at Navy. So there were experiments. There was those cubes of polyurea that they were putting, and they were also putting the continuous polyurea layer. So and so we're studying of how those particles here enhance the energy absorption properties. So obviously it's a problem at multiple scales here, because you know have those particles here. And so this was actually an optimization problem. And we tried to tell to a Navy how to disperse those particles, right? And so the idea turns out to be that the best thing was to absorb those particles in such a way that they were at some angle to the plane, not horizontal, not vertical, but most of them to be at some angle. And from the physics point of view, what it allows, it turns the wave propagation from compression wave to more shear wave. And it turns out to be that this poluria can absorb energy when it's a shear wave. That was kind of explanation of what we have found. And this is also an example where if you disperse those particles at an angle, primarily at 45 degrees, if you can disperse in such a way, then actually in this case, this projectile did not penetrate. And if you would not do that, if you would do that in a completely random fashion, then this penetrator actually penetrates. We also apply this thing to multi-physics problems in both polymer systems and ceramic systems. So this is basically a coupled diffusion reaction system combined with the mechanical system. So the diffusion reaction system in polymers, this is of interest to the car manufacturers, where they're interested in to see how moisture affects the strengths and the modulus of the cars, right? And so some polymer systems, they absorb more moisture. And they are becoming not very good. In ceramics, you have some micro cracks, so oxygen penetrates. It reacts. It opens new pathways towards oxygen to penetrate. So the mechanical problem of micro crack propagation has an effect on the diffusion problem. Right. So it's again, you know, systems that we worked on.
I do not know what are renegade materials.
Oh, renegade is a material manufacturer. Yeah, they actually are the ones that are producing. So also the interest here is in high temperature polymer matrix composites that can withstand 500 centigrade temperatures. So I didn't talk about the stochastics, but you know, this approach can be used to generate A and B basis allowables. We have been using Monte Carlo. We have been also using things like a sparse grid collocation approach, where you actually discretize the random space, and using spatial quadrature schemes in multiple dimensions to integrate in a stochastic space. We also use things like I think what you have mentioned, Graziella. We're using stochastic methods for parameter identification, right? So once you have an error in the experimental data, you know, some PDF, try to identify the PDF or the microstructure so that we can analyze the problems that have distributions. So that's pretty much it. I just want to finish here with a slide that I think you have mentioned, Ismail. This is about the Congress that's going to be July 22 to 27. The nice thing about that is it's going to be held in Marriott Marquis. If you look from the windows, you see the Times Square, right? So it's right in the Times Square. You know, a lot of things. So you're all very much invited to attend this.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your excellent talk.